since the election outcomes, which were influenced very significantly by the events of Fulwana and Balakot, seem to suggest that the economic crisis did not weigh very heavily on people's minds in exercising their electoral choices. And once again, the media have generally not been highlighting these issues of the crisis of livelihoods of the peasants and workers of India. However, suddenly now we have a lot of noise in the mainstream media on the economic slowdown right now. And of course, the highlight, of course, has been the crisis in the automobile sector, fast-moving consumer goods sector, some other sectors, including textile sector, which has been less highlighted. But the real estate sector has found a lot of mention. And in the light of critical comments and concerns expressed by leading lights of Indian industry, people like the TVS or Rahul Bajaj or Godrej or leader of the Parleys and Britannia biscuit companies, while the government continues to be in denial, it has nonetheless been forced to appear to act quickly on these issues. Now that's very instructive, because what it suggests is that the problems of millions of Indians are not a much concern to the state, but the problems of a very small elite are immediately seen as critical and addressed, or at least sought to be addressed in some public and visible manner. And this is something not entirely new to us. It happened with the farmer suicides in the 80s and in the 90s as well. The narrative from the side of the captains of industry is all about how government policies are not helping revive the economy, including to the point where they would like government to be more active, spend more money, create demand and all that. But more importantly, they would like to see government address their concerns over taxation. In all this narrative, one thing is happening, which is that after a long period of denial, both captains of industry and even government spokespersons, like some people in the Ministry of Finance, the vice chairperson of the Niti Aayog and so on, have finally started admitting that the demonetization and the hasty and remarkably confused implementation of the GST have hurt the economy quite badly. But what is interesting is that when the captains of industry say there is trouble, the government listens. When lakhs of farmers commit suicide, the government cannot be overly bothered. Likewise with the massive unemployment, on which the government in fact refused to divulge data for a long time. So today we have a situation which is somewhat peculiar. Government data on GDP are no longer trusted even by government spokespersons. What concerns me in this discussion is not so much the specific number on the rate of growth per se, but the character of that growth process, which I, as I mentioned earlier, has been highly exclusive in its implications. We had two statements in recent times, one from the finance minister in her budget and one by the prime minister in his Independence Day address, which are nearly identical. In both statements, what is the key point? Corporate India is the wealth creator in this country. For me, it was an extraordinary statement. I had always imagined that working people, peasants, workers, office people, people who work in management levels in various institutions, people who work by hand also with their intellect, all these working people, right up to the highest managerial levels, are producing wealth in this country. Stock market allows transfer of wealth from one party to another, but not the production of it. And yet we are now told, not the private sector, mind you, not the public sector, mind you, but the corporate sector is the creator of wealth. And therefore, we are supposed to be nice to them. This is the narrative that is being unfolded by the ruling regime. I think it's important for us, first of all, to challenge this and to make the point that whether you take wealth creation or you take payment of taxes, the major contribution comes from working people. They pay the bulk of the indirect taxes. They produce the country's wealth through the hard work. Whereas our system rewards property ownership and not labor, not work, intellectual, physical, manual, whatever. So I'm not making a distinction between different kinds of work. All kinds of work are relevant to the creation of wealth in the country. What you must notice is that while the minister has been very careful in not making big financial commitments to Indian corporate sector and Indian industry, including the auto sector, she has been quite willing to meet the demands of the foreign portfolio investors. Their demands have been met in toto. They have removed the surcharge, the taxes that were there in the budget on the FPIs. And this is very symptomatic of the nature of the crisis that the government perceives India to be in. And this is the following. Since 1991, practically in every single quarter, every three-month period, the value of exports of India's physical goods has been far less than the value of imports of physical goods. In other words, you've run a very large merchandise trade deficit for a very long time. This would have been a very unsustainable situation, except for the fact that we were able to get some foreign exchange through two sources. One, our net exports of services, IT, IT-enabled services, tourism, and so on. And we got some foreign exchange through repatriation of their incomes, remittances by working people of India living abroad, not by the art of leaving people, not by the big captains of industry, but by ordinary working people going from different parts of India and working under difficult conditions and sending home money, unskilled, semi-skilled, skilled workers who sent home their money. After you take into account remittances plus net service sector exports earnings, you still have a large current account deficit. Now, this is what compels the government of India to desperately seek foreign exchange without regard to the use to which such inflows will be put. So, for example, you are desperate to get foreign portfolio investment, even though you know this only comes into the stock market or commodity market, comes in for purely speculative reasons, does not add to output or wealth creation or employment or technology in any way. But you're desperate because you have liberalized trade so much. You've fallen in line with the impositions on you by the advanced countries that your large trade deficit, which is also a reflection of your failure to improve your exports, has compelled you to desperately seek foreign exchange inflows, regardless of what use they are put to. So, you know, it's an extraordinary situation where the FPI demands are wholly addressed, but the demands of even the Indian big bourgeoisie are only partially addressed. I think it gives you an indication of the nature of the regime at the moment, notwithstanding its protestations of being Swadeshi and all that, as to exactly where their you know, inclinations lie. The basic point is, without substantial investment in India's infrastructure, which is going to primarily have to come not from a reluctant private sector, but a public sector, large-scale public investment in large number of sectors, which will help industry raise its productivity, help India's exports compete better, investments in the public sector in health, education, infrastructure, and a whole lot of other areas. Without all that, India is not going to be able to improve its export competitiveness, address the trade deficit, and without revisiting the issue of trade regulation and tightening it, we will find it very difficult to sustain the kind of development that we are currently having. We will have a recurrent and permanent forex crisis, which will induce us to submit ourselves to the dictates of speculative foreign capital, as it is happening at the moment. So we are currently surrendering to the dictates of speculative foreign finance capital, and that regulates your entire policy framework. For example, you will not spend more on health and education because you're afraid that your budget deficits will go up, which will be frowned upon by the foreign finance capitalists. And you will not raise resources from the rich in order to spend, even while meeting the budget deficit targets, because you will be concerned about the tax incentive effects on the rich. So we have created an atmosphere in which any rate of taxation is seen as punitive. Any increase thereon is considered unthinkable. And we have this constant prattle about 30% and 20% tax rates. After all exemptions are taken into account, the effective corporate tax rate is much less than 23%. It's not 30%. Currently, companies earning 400 crore rupees more or less as turnover each year, or enjoying, after Nirmala Sitharaman's budget, or enjoying 25% tax rates nominally, and much lower once exemptions kick in. We have not removed any exemptions. Now, the idea is to extend this to all corporate sector entities, which would then mean even lower tax revenue for Government of India. The GST is in crisis, so the GST revenues are not going to, you know, come up in a big way, which is why Sitharaman has not yielded on the GST rate. There is a government has this budget deficit to manage. So essentially, you are caught in a bind of both a fiscal crisis and a balance of payments crisis. Ironically, these were the two that were put forward as the reasons for moving to neoliberal policies in 1991. 30 years later, we are back to square one, where the same fiscal deficit crisis and the balance of payments crisis are staring you in the face. And the way out of this is not through more concessions to the corporate sector, but through a different path of development. In fact, the slowdown that we are talking about is only one facet of the Indian economy. The narrowness of the Indian market resides, first of all, in the failure to carry out comprehensive land reforms. If you take any successful Asian country, Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, and People's Republic of China, all these have carried out comprehensive land reforms. So for the lesson for India, therefore, would be that we should now not look at short-term solutions of just trying to sustain this very exclusivist economy by providing more concessions to the corporates without reference to employment, but rather our priority issue should be agrarian crisis and unemployment, which in turn would require comprehensive land reforms as well as massive programs of employment. In fact, at the moment, obviously land reform is a longer term question, but immediately if you look at the budget, for example, there's been a reduction in the outlay for rural employment guarantee program. What we need is a far more massive urban and rural employment program which will build productive assets for the Indian economy in the public sector. What we need is much greater public investment. All of this requires a reversal of neoliberal policies and a much more proactive state policy, because without investment, the economy is not going to grow, and without such public investment, you will not be able to improve productivity for agriculture. Ultimately, the crisis in agriculture has to be solved by improving productivity in agriculture for the mass of the cultivators. And that cannot be done without, for example, a much stronger self system in agriculture, a much stronger extension system, much stronger levels of investment for helping farmers to store their produce, carry it to the market, and irrigation, and a whole lot of other things which one can talk about. So basically, massive public investment is required, whereas we are currently traveling in the reverse direction. In the last 3 years alone, the Modi regime has disinvested or has planned to disinvest around 3 lakh crore rupees of public sector enterprises assets. This is committing suicide. I mean, today when private sector investment has basically collapsed, the only kind of investment that can lift the economy would be massive public investment. But that does require both more effective taxation and the willingness to run larger deficits for some time, which both require much greater relative independence from the demands of international finance capital and from the pressures of big bourgeoisie inside the country, big capital inside the country. I think we need to follow those kinds of policies, but those are easier said than done. I don't see any other way out of this, in the long run, more sustainable way out of this crisis. Thank you.